بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون. ما أريد منهم من رزق وما أريد أن يطعمون.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله. اما بعد، فان خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الامور محدثاتها وكل محدثه بدعه وكل بدعه ضلاله وكل ضلاله في النار. وقال تعالى في كلامه المجيد: ان الله لا يغفر ان يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء ومن يشرك بالله فقد افترى اثما عظيما. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقده من لساني يفقهوا قولي. I welcome all of you brothers and sisters. Our subject today is what is Allah's right on his creation. What is Allah's right on his creation, specifically man? My dear brothers and sisters, we all know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us uncountable number of favors. Allah says in the Quran in Surah An-Nahl, Surah 16, verse number 18, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you were to count the number of favors of Allah, you cannot even number them. You cannot even number them. Why we can't number them? Somebody said, why we can't number? We have numbers running up to crores, millions and billions. We can count. That okay, eyes is one favor. One favor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us sight. Second favor, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us ability to hear. We can count. Why we can't count? The answer is given in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاسْبَغَ عَلَيْكُمْ نِيمَهُ ظَاهِرًا وَبَاطِنًا. Allah has poured on you his favors, zahir and batin, open and hidden. We can count open things possibly, but we surely can't count hidden things. See, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us so many favors that so many of them are still unknown to us. When the ozone layer started depleting, that's when we came to know we had an ozone layer which was protecting us from the bad effects of the sun. So now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says Allah has sent so many favors on us. And of course, can anybody count every heartbeat? Can we count every time we are breathing? Every time we are breathing, that's a favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every breath is a favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every heartbeat is a favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, dear brothers and sisters, let's all be realistic. The fact is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us so much that we are so indebted that we can never repay anything. But Allah has a right on us. We need to know that, see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us things without even asking. We didn't even ask. Did we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, I'm going in the world. Oh Allah, I'm going to the world. Now I need two eyes, I need two hands, I need fingers, I need a tongue. We didn't tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah gave us without even asking. Now what is his right on us? See, mankind, any man, whether he agrees with all of this or whether he doesn't agree with all of this, he is indebted to the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he asked a question as recorded in Sahih Bukhari. He asked the Sahaba that, do you know what is Allah's right on his creation? So they said, Allah and his messenger know the best. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he said, Allah's right on his creation is that man should not worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Man should not worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah's right on the creation is La ilaha illallah. There is none worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But dear brothers and sisters, we live in a world which is full of shirk. Shirk is the opposite of tawheed. Tawheed comes from wahada yuwahidu, means to maintain the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shirk is the opposite of tawheed. It means associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we live in a world where there is abundance of shirk. We find people from different walks of life, different backgrounds, educated and illiterate, people from all races and castes, they are doing shirk. Now, dear brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us so much. And there are major misconceptions about shirk. The first misconception about shirk is that people feel that only idol worship is shirk. When actually, idol worship is one of the forms of shirk. But there are many other forms of shirk. There is so much to know about this on the subject. There's so much to maintain, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it compulsory to maintain Tawheed. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Nisa, Surah number 4, verse number 48, Inna Allaha la yaghfiru an yushraka bihi. Allah will never forgive that you join partners with Him. Wa yaghfiru ma duna dhalika liman yasha. But He may forgive a sin other than that to whoever He pleases. Ma duna is other than that or lesser than that. Because shirk, kufr and nifaq, all of these three are unforgivable sins. Ma duna is lesser than that. So we need to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa yaghfiru ma duna dhalika liman yasha. He may forgive a sin other than that to whoever He pleases. Why? وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ Allah says, for the one who joins partners with Allah, فَقَدْ افْتَرَى إِثْمًا عَظِيمًا. He has done the most heinous sin. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Nisa, Surah 4, verse number 116, وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ The one who associates partners with Allah, فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا بَيِّدًا. He has gone on a very far misguidance. And Allah says in the Quran in Surah Maidah, Surah 5, verse 72, إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ Surely the one who associates partners with Allah, فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ Allah will make Jannat haram for him. Allah will make Jannat haram. وَمَاوَهُ النَّارِ And his place, his destination will be the fire of hell. وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارِ And the wrongdoers shall have no helper. They shall have no helper, especially at a time when they need help. Now, dear brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has highlighted this problem with such a striking example that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the example of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. See, a person may think that, see, I'm a nice man. I'm a nice person. Even if I was to do shirk, I'm doing so many good deeds. I went for Hajj. I pray Salah. I give so much charity. Now, we need to know, if a person does lots of good deeds, but he does shirk, what will happen? If he has many good deeds, but he's doing shirk, there's so many people who do lots of good things, apparently it looks so good. But if they do shirk, then what will happen? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the example of his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says in the Quran, in Surah Zumar, Surah number 39, verse number 65, لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ O Prophet, if you were to do shirk, if you were to do shirk, layahbatan namaluk, all your good deeds would go vain. All your good deeds would go vain. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the example of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's enough for anybody to understand. See, can we imagine Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam standing in the night and praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hatta tawarramat qadamahu, until his feet would get swollen? And imagine such sincerity, such ikhlas, such concentration. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the example of these deeds of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. لَيَحْبَطَنَّ مَلُكُ All your deeds would go vain if you were to do shirk. So now this is enough for anyone to understand. See, if a class teacher tells the best student, if you don't do homework tomorrow, even you are going to be leaving, even you will be standing outside the class. So now what will happen? All the best students will, as it is, understand that if he is going to leave, what are we? So now when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's example has been given, all those with lesser deeds can understand on their own. Now, dear brothers and sisters, what's the action plan? The action plan is, let us today study this subject in a very brief and summarized manner, but to know what is the scope of Tawheed. And I'm aware there will be some brothers and sisters who already know this subject. But it's important to know that there are so many people who are able to understand, but they can't explain. They can't explain. And alhamdulillah, the subject which I am taking right now, we have ready notes available in English and Urdu both. So I suggest that those of you who have further interest, who want to save someone from this severe sin of shirk, then the biggest service that you can do in this cause is study this subject and share the knowledge with someone. See, brothers and sisters, the scope of Tawheed is very vast. And we need to know what are the passing marks in this subject. To pass in this subject, how many marks are needed? See, normally in school exams, 35% is passing. But in this subject, Tawheed, the subject of Tawheed, what is the passing percentage? How many marks does a person need? Any guesses? 35, 50, more than 50? 90, 10% you should allow, 100%. If a person does little bit shirk, Tawheed is gone. He's failed in the subject. You need 100% marks. And as we proceed further, we will see that there are so many things which people say without even thinking, and that has shirk. Let's start. Very frequently it happens that a person maintains Tawheed in one aspect, also in the second aspect at times, but he misses out on Tawheed and thus shirk in the third aspect. Dear brothers and sisters, inshallah, to have good control, good inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have good command on this subject, ulama have divided the subject into three parts. First part, second part, third part. And the first part is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone is the Rabb. Allah alone is the Rabb. See, what is the meaning of Rabb? Rabb is the Lord, the cherisher, the sustainer, the maintainer, the creator, the one who controls everything. As Allah says in the Quran in Surah An'am, Surah number 6, verse number 164, Qul, tell them, أَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ أَبْغِي رَبًّا وَهُوَ رَبُّ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. Say, shall I take for my creator, shall I take for my Rabb anyone other than Allah, when He is the Rabb of everything? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Rabb. Now what is the meaning of Rabb? One of the things included in the meaning of Rabb is He alone is the creator. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah Zumar, Surah number 39, verse number 62, Allahu khaliqu kulli shay'in wa huwa ala kulli shay'in wakeel. Allah alone is the creator of everything, and He alone is the controller of everything, wakeel. Now dear brothers and sisters, Allah alone is the creator. Everything has been created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not need anybody's help, does not have any partner in His creation. Secondly, He alone is the owner. Allah alone is the owner. Allah says in the Quran, in many places, لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. To Allah belong everything in the heavens and the earth. Everything in the heavens and the earth, it belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now we need to know, dear brothers and sisters, that every single thing, the owner is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let me give you an example. Let's say that one of you has a phone. Can we have some example? Somebody's phone? Okay. Whose phone is this? Okay, now, brother, tell me. You're the owner of this phone. Who made this phone? This particular company. Now imagine if this phone is crying. You don't mind? Imagine this phone is crying. This phone is not well taken care of. Can the company, can the maker do anything for this phone? Can the company do anything for this phone? Why? Why they can't do? They're not the owner. He's the owner. The company made it and sold it to someone else. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not do something like this. Allah is the creator, and Allah alone is the owner. Sure? Then who's the owner of this? Then who's the owner of this? Allah is the owner of everything. So what about your car, your house? What about your mobile? What about everything we have? Who's the owner? Who's the owner? What do you think? The owner is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are not the owner. If we were the owner, we would have taken it with us and gone. That now he's died, put his mobile phone also in his grave. We are not the owner. If we were the owner, we would have taken our things with us. But we are not the owner. Allah is the owner. Allah gave us these things to test us. Allah alone is the owner of everything. He alone is the creator. He alone is the owner. He alone is the controller. Allah says in the Quran in Surah As-Sajda, Surah number 32, verse number 5. Yudabbirul amra minas samai ilal ard. Allah alone is the planner, is the one who does tadbeer, planning, management. Min as-samai ilal ard, of everything from the heavens to the earth. Everything is controlled by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Hud, Surah number 11, verse number 6, Allah says that وَمَا مِن دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا. There is no living creature on the earth, but Allah is the one who provides risk, sustenance. And what kind of sustenance He provides? See, if we were to look at the varieties of mangoes, so many varieties of mangoes, the varieties in fishes, the varieties in different types of rice, different type of vegetables. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Alallahi rizquha. Allah is the one who gives us sustenance. وَهُوَ يُتْئِمُ وَلَا يُتَمُ. He's the one who feeds, He doesn't need to be fed. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives sustenance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who controls good and bad. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Yunus, Surah number 10, verse number 107. And this is a very important verse on the subject. I recommend very strongly that try to memorize the Arabic text of this ayat. Inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will find many opportunities to quote this. Allah says in the Quran, وَإِن يَمْسَسْكَ اللَّهُ بِدُرِّن. If Allah sends on you some difficulty, if Allah sends on you some difficulty, فَلَا كَشْفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُوَ. Then no one can solve that difficulty except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who's the solver of difficulty? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is the one who gives difficulties as a test, and He alone can solve difficulty. فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُوَ. There is none who can solve that difficulty except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then dear brothers and sisters, why do people say, oh so and so, help me. Oh so and so, help me. Why do they say that so and so is the biggest helper, when Allah alone is the biggest helper? فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُوَ. There is none who can solve difficulties except Him. وَإِن يُرِدْكَ بِخَيْرٍ. If Allah intends good for you, فَلَا رَادَّ لِفَضْلِهِ. Then no one can stop that ni'mah from coming to you. No one can stop that blessing from coming to you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala controls difficulties. He controls ni'mah. What else do we want? See, a person needs that all ni'mahs and blessings should come to me and no difficulty should come on me. This is the basic demand of every human being. This is what he wants, every human being wants. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who controls all of this. فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُوَ وَنْ يُرِدْكَ بِخَيْرٍ فَلَا رَادَّ لِفَضْلِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran in Surah Nahl, Surah 16 verse 53, Allah says, وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ. There is no blessing, but it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every blessing is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Good and bad is both in the hands of Allah alone. Now, dear brothers and sisters, I have a question for you. And I want all of you to open up. Whatever you think to be correct, you can speak up. Even if you are wrong, we are just brothers and sisters sitting to learn Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's deen. Tell me, whatever problems come on a person, difficulties come on a person, is that also controlled by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or is that controlled by shaitan? Is that problem from shaitan, or is it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Problem is from whom? From Allah or from shaitan?
From our own selves.
It's not from Allah. Then, this is a common answer. Is it from shaitan? Problems are also from Allah. Somebody's hand broke. From whom has that come? Somebody lost in his business. Somebody fell sick. All of these problems are from whom? Who is the one who controls them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See, the correct answer is all of this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the belief of the Zoroastrians who believe that there are two gods. One is Ahura Mazda, the god of good, and second is Ahirman, the god of evil. We don't believe this. We believe Allah controls everything. There's no competition between two gods for good and bad. And what we think to be bad may in reality be good. It may be good for a person. For example, a person, his scale of good deeds, he had lesser good deeds and more sins. Now his hand had an accident and he had a fracture. And lot of pain, lot of difficulty, his sins are being forgiven. He's doing sabr. His sins are being forgiven. And then his scale of good deeds becomes heavier in comparison to the scale of bad deeds, and he goes to Jannah. Was that good for him or bad for him? He said, how bad, my hand is fractured. But in reality, it was good, he'll realize on the day of judgment. So now Allah says in the Quran that وَإِن يُرِدْكَ بِخَيْرٍ فَلَا رَادَّ لِفَضْلِهِ. If he intends good for you, no one can stop it from coming to you. Acha, tell me, have you heard if a black cat cuts your way, then what we should do? What should we do? Tell me. See, I'll tell you something. If someone gives a wrong answer, it's no problem over here. Why? Because we're sitting to learn Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's deen. There's no harm in it. Let us all open up so at least we can learn something, inshallah. There are two things which stop a person from learning. One is haya, when he says, oh, I don't want to show, I don't know. And second is arrogance. You're going to teach me? Huh? So now, both ways, we should not let anything stop us from learning. Huh? So, okay, tell me. What should we do when a black cat cuts our way? Continue. What do you think? What do brothers over there think? Somebody invariably normally says that we should say Bismillah and then continue. What do you think? We have a place to say Bismillah, and that's when we start from home. There's nothing special to happen when a black cat is cutting our way. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if Allah intends good for you, no one can stop it from coming to you. Do we think that the black cat can stop it from coming to us? The black cat can stop the good from coming to us? No. Good and bad is in the hands of Allah alone. Correct? The black cat cannot even stop bad from coming on its own self. Someone said in one of our discussions, he said, no, see, some things are a sign that something bad is going to come. Said, the black cat cutting your way, this is a sign that something bad is going to come to you. But the thing is, if it was so, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have surely told us that, see, this is a sign, that is a sign. He didn't tell us. And we say that apparently we can't see any such thing happening. Yes, for sure, if a tiger cuts your way, and this is a sign something bad is going to come to you, isn't it? But a black cat, what can it do? Similarly, the stones. You know, it's famous for that people wear stones in their rings. And they say that, see, I didn't have had so many problems, and I lost my job, and ever since I started wearing this ring, I got my job back, and so many problems, they got solved. Who solved these problems? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the stone, does it have anything to do? Does it have any power? No power. The stone, does it have any power? No power. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone has all the power. And if someone says that the stone also has some power, then what do we think? Then what? If you say the stone also has power, then divide the percentage. What percentage is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? 90%, 95%? And how much in the hands of the stone? 5%, 10%? It's obvious Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone has 100% control over everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone has 100% control without any partner of even any fractional point. Allah alone controls everything. Now, dear brothers and sisters, what we need to know is that this comes in many different forms. Have you heard someone say, Pata nahi aaj subah kiska muh dekha, mera pura din kharab ho gaya? Huh? Have you heard someone say this? Now, I don't know whose face I've seen today morning. My entire day was spoiled. But nothing happens by looking at anybody's face. Who controls good and bad? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly, we find, you have seen feng shui, the rattles, it keeps on ringing, ting ting. People believe it brings in some good. It brings in good. You think it has any power to bring in good? Huh? It has any power to bring in good? No. Who has the power to bring in good? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The feng shui rattles, they don't have any power. Similarly, we find Vastu Shastra in India. People say that, see, you have your sofa kept like this, and your windows on this side, and the door there, instead of over there, if you had your door on this side, or you had the window on this side, or you sit with your chair, instead of sitting facing like this, you sit facing like this, and your things will change for you. So will it change? Huh? Is it allowed to do this? Is it allowed or not? It's not allowed. If a person does that, then what does he believe? It's shirk. Do we realize it's shirk? Now, if I want to change my window from this direction to that direction so that I can get better air, is it allowed? It's allowed or not allowed? But you said you're not allowed to change your windows. Huh? For the sake of the intention being that this is vastu compliant. Huh? Then that's shirk compliant. It's tawheed non-compliant. Dear brothers and sisters, So now we find shirk is in so many such forms. If a mirror breaks, something bad is going to come. Something bad is going to happen. So now people believe, they believe in taweez. It's so common. Some problem comes in the house, wear this taweez. See, this taweez is going to help you. What did the Prophet ﷺ say? We have the hadith recorded in Musnad Ahmad and also in Mustadrak Hakim, authenticated by Sheikh Albani and graded to be Sahih in Sahih al-Jami. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Man allaqa tamimatan faqad ashraka." Whoever hangs the tamima, he has done shirk. And the Prophet ﷺ did not make any exception that you can hang a tamima which contains Quranic verses. As people say, see, this is Quranic verses. The Prophet ﷺ did not say that you can hang a tamima. Tamima is taweez, something like a taweez. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, did not say that you can have a Quranic taweez. To the extent we have a hadith recorded in Sunan Tirmidhi, graded to be Hasan li ghayrihi in Sahih al-Targhib, hadith number 345, hadith number 3456. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Man allaqa shayin, faqad wukila ilay." Whoever hangs something, then he is entrusted to it. He's entrusted to it, meaning he starts believing in it. Now he started hanging it. Okay, I'm just hanging because my mommy told me. And then he said, "Oh, I can't go out." If you tell him, you remove your taweez and you go out, no, something will happen to me on the way. Faqad wukila ilay, he starts believing in it. So now, dear brothers and sisters, this is shirk. People think that threads, you know, the different kind of threads that are available. They say that, see, this has some power. It's from some great person's grave. It has the power to bring in good and to stop bad things from coming to us. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone controls everything. So now, dear brothers and sisters, what do we learn from all of this? These are different forms of attributing good and bad in the hands of other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah alone is the creator. Allah alone is the owner. He alone is the controller. He alone gives us sustenance. He alone controls all good. He alone controls all bad. Bad is also controlled by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What we think to be bad. But Allah knows what is better for us. Further we find, He is the one who controls life and death. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Ra'd, Surah number 30, verse number 40, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Allahu alladhi khalaqakum." Allah is the one who created you. "Thumma razaqakum." He gave you sustenance. "Thumma yuhyikum." Then He gave you life. "Thumma yumitukum." Then He gave you death. "Hal min shurakaikum man yafalu min dhalikum min shayin." Are there any of your partners who can do any of this? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, He gives life, He gives us death. He gives us sickness, He gives us cure. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Shuara, Surah number 26, verse number 80, that وَإِذَا مَرِدُتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِينَ. When I am sick, Allah is the one who cures me. So now people say, doctor kya kiye? See, let us know. The doctor is a means. He is not the cause. If Allah wants to cure a person, He can cure a person even without the doctor and without medicine. But if the medicine was to become the cure, it can become the cure only by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only by the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now what do we know? Allah is the one who gives us sickness. He gives us cure. He gives us children. He gives us everything that has been given to us has been given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah alone is the controller of everything. A simple example for anyone to think. If someone thinks that there are some great people who control something, as people say, they say when they go to certain places, they say, "Bhar de jholi, tere dar se nahi jaunga khali." You know, fill my jholi, fill my, what do you call it? Huh? Give me something. I won't go empty-handed from your place. But who gives? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives. This is shirk. This is shirk. People don't even realize, but this is shirk. Just because a person says la ilaha illallah, it doesn't mean that he can't have shirk. There are people who say la ilaha illallah and yet they do shirk. So now these are different things which Allah alone controls everything. This is aqeedah, this is our belief. And Allah says in the Quran in Surah Zumar, Surah 39, verse number 36, "Alaysa Allahu bikahfin abda." Is Allah not sufficient for His slave? Is Allah not sufficient for you? Is He not enough for you? Allah says in the Quran in Surah Al-Anbiya, Surah 21, verse 22, that لَوْ كَانَ فِيهِمَا آلِهَةٌ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, that if there were in the heavens and the earth gods other than Allah, لَفَسَدَتَ, surely there would have been chaos and confusion. If any person, any great personality, anything was to control anything in the universe, what would have happened? لَفَسَدَتَ, there would have been fasad. There would have been chaos and confusion. So Allah alone is the controller of everything, and this is Allah's right on His creation, that people should realize that Allah alone is the controller. This is section number one. Now we come to section number two. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Shura, Surah number 42, ayat number 11, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is none like unto Him. And our second section is, there is none like unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is none equal to Him, as given in the Quran in Surah Ikhlas, Surah number 112, verse number 4. وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. There is no kufu, there is no equal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Surah Shura, Surah 42, ayat number 11 says, there is none who is like Him. There is none like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, brothers and sisters, people make a mistake in this. The mistake they make is that they attribute Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names and attributes to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See, let us know, how many names does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have? Huh? The famous answer is 99. But the correct answer is, who can give the correct answer? 114. Any other answer, any other choice? How many names does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have? The correct answer is uncountable. We don't even know. What's the proof of this? The Prophet ﷺ did dua that As'aluka bi kulli ismin huwa laka. O Allah, I ask you by every name that belongs to you. Sammayta bihi nafsak, which you have named yourself. Or anzalta fi kitabik, or you have sent down in your book. Or allamta ahadim min khalkik, or you have taught any of your creation. And listen to the last part. Awista sarta bihi fi ilmil ghaybi indak, or which you have concealed in your ilme ghaib, which is with you, or which you have concealed in your ilme ghaib, which is with you. So the correct answer is, we don't even know the number of names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the names asma. And let us know, asma and sifat. Sifat is attribute, quality. Whatever is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's also the quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Name and quality, whatever is the name is the quality. For example, among human beings, we find so many times that somebody's name is, please don't mind, I'm not pointing to someone, it's just an example. Now somebody's name may be Adil Bhai. Now, but there may be some Adil who is a big zalim. It happens at times the name is something and the person is something else. Have we seen this? You've also seen? Now this is not with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ar-Rahman, He is Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, He is Ar-Rahim, He is Al-Aziz, He is Al-Aziz. All the names are also the attributes. So all the names are attributes, but all the attributes are not names. Like for example, لَا تَاخُذُهُ سِنَةٌ وَلَا نَوْمٌ. No slumber, no sleep can overcome Him. Now this is not a name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is an attribute, but it's not a name. That the one who doesn't get sleep. No, this is not His name. This is His quality, that no slumber, no sleep can overcome Him. This is the quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now tell me, which chapter would be more vast? The chapter of names or the chapter of sifat? Huh? The chapter of sifat. Why? Because all the names are sifat, but all the sifat are not names. Okay? Now we have to maintain the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all the names and all the sifat. What is to be maintained? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said there is none like unto Him. When He has said there is none like Him, Allah says in the Quran in Surah Buruj, Surah number 85, verse number 16, فَآلُ لِمَا يُرِيدُ. Allah does that which He wills. Allah does that which He intends. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do that which He intends. Allah will not do anything which will contradict His kalam. As some people say, they say, see, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with someone, when He is very happy with someone, He gives him one of His qualities. They say that. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all-knowing, al-aleem. So they say when Allah is pleased with someone, Allah will give him also the quality of, He's also all-knowing now. And Allah is as-sami, all-hearing. So now Allah gave the quality of as-sami, being as-sami to him, another human being. Oh, you also as-sami, I'm very happy with you. Is that so? Is that so? Allah says in the Quran in Surah Nisa, the answer is, Surah 4, verse number 122. وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ قِيلًا. Who is more truthful than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Who is more truthful than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When Allah said, لَيْسَ, can we all memorize this ayat? If we repeat together, we can memorize right now, inshallah. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ There is none like unto him. When there is none like unto him, there will never be someone like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will not make anyone like unto him. If he makes someone like him, then this ayat of the Quran is not correct anymore. Then this turns out to be wrong. So, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ Now, dear brothers and sisters, people say that, see, this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's ilm is zati. And Allah ta'ala gives to someone, then it becomes atai. Allah gave so and so. But let us know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never give something by which the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is proved to be false. He alone is, there's none equal to him, and there's none like unto him. And it's a mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See, how much can we hear? We can hear only this much. Before this program, when the voice was not reaching the sisters, how much difficulty we had. Because we can't hear beyond this. Imagine, if someone was to hear everything that's happening in the universe. All the human beings, all the machines, all the animals, all the jinns. Everything if you can hear, then what will happen? What will happen? Huh? If you can hear all the sounds, what will happen within a few minutes? Or a few seconds possibly. A person will go mad. Isn't it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mercy on us that He gave us limited ability of listening and limited ability of knowing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our Rahim. And none of the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are possible for a human being. Because human beings are weak. خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفَ Allah says, I have created man weak. So now dear brothers and sisters, the common mistake which people do is they give the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to someone other than Allah. This is a mistake. This is shirk. This is shirk. And there's another mistake which people do. Is that they play around with the names and attributes. They accept some and they deny some. Whatever Allah has affirmed for Himself, we also affirm for Him. As Allah says in the Quran in Surah Nahl, Surah 16, verse number 74, فَلَا تَضْرِبُوا لِلَّهِ الْأَمْثَالِ Don't give examples for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ Because Allah knows and you don't know. You don't know, so don't talk without knowledge. And Allah says in the Quran, the core reason why people make mistakes in this section, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, Surah 4, verse number 171, وَلَا تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْحَقِّ Do not say about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except the haq, the truth. And what is the truth? Al-haqqu min rabbikum. The truth is from your Lord. As given in Surah Kahf, Surah number 18, verse number 29. The truth is from your Lord. So now we should not speak about Allah's names and attributes without knowledge. We're not allowed to speak. This subject is taqifi. Taqifi comes from wukuf. Wukuf means you see the circle at the end of the ayat, stop there. So this subject, you speak what is given in the Quran, what's given in the Sunnah, and you stop there. We're not allowed to speak from our own side. So now, we find people make some mistakes, and ulama have warned people from stopping from these mistakes. We don't have time to go into that right now. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran in Surah Araf, Surah 7, verse number 180, لِلَّهِ وَلِلَّهِ أَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى And to Allah belong the most beautiful names. فَدُوهُ بِهَا Then call Allah by these names. Call Allah by these names. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ Allah says in the Quran, وَذَرُوا الَّذِينَ يُلْحِدُونَ فِي أَسْمَائِهِ And leave those people. Leave those people meaning, don't seek knowledge from them. Don't learn your deen from them. And they're from the Ahlul Bidah, so it's not good to hang around too much with the Ahlul Bidah. Allah says, وَذَرُوا الَّذِينَ يُلْحِدُونَ فِي أَسْمَائِهِ Leave those who practice deviations regarding the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now regarding the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ulama have defined four different deviations. One is ta'til, that is denying the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Second is tahrif, changing one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Third is tamthil, giving examples for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And fourth is taqif, is asking how or giving description of one of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now we remember this and we go ahead to the third section. The third section is maintaining the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His ibadah, in His worship. As Allah says in the Quran in Surah Ad-Dhariyat, Surah number 51, verse number 56, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ I have created jinns and men only so that they may worship me. So we have to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. See, obviously, when Allah alone is the Rabb, we saw that He alone is the creator, the owner, the controller, the one who controls good and one who gives us bad to test us. the one who gives sickness, the one who cures us, the one who gives life, the one who gives death, when he alone is the Rabb, then whom should we worship? How can we worship someone who doesn't control, who doesn't create? How can we worship someone who doesn't own anything? How can we worship someone who has no control over good and bad? How can we worship someone who doesn't give life and death? How can we worship someone who doesn't give us sustenance? How can we worship someone who doesn't give sickness and cure? How can we worship someone who doesn't give children, who doesn't give, do anything? How can we worship someone who is not the Rabb? Only the Rabb should be worshipped. Now this is where people go wrong. Several people, they say we worship, we attribute acts of, we do acts of worship to please so and so. Now this is a mistake. The fact is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made us say this in the first chapter of the Quran. Where? Which sentence? إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. You alone we worship and only your aid we seek. So we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us that you alone we worship and only your aid we seek. So we ask only whose help? We ask only whose help? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dua is what? Dua is ibadah. As the hadith of Abu Dawud is, Allah's Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ad-dua huwa al-ibadah. Dua is ibadah. So dua is worship. When we ask someone, this is worship. So now are we allowed to ask someone for something? Are we allowed to ask someone for something? Who will answer? Can we ask someone for something? No? Or yes? Can I ask you, can you please give me some water? Was this shirk? I asked him for some water. Is this shirk? Or is it okay? So, وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. Only your aid we seek. Then what's this? Remember three rules. First is, if I'm asking Brother Usman, please give me some water. So Usman has to be living. A person who's dead and gone, we say, oh, so and so, please give me some water. Not allowed. First rule, the person should be living. The second rule, he should be present. Brother Usman is in Saudi, I say, Brother Usman, please give me some water. Not allowed. The first rule is, he should be living. Second rule, present. Third rule, he should have be qadir. Qadir meaning capable. Meaning I can ask him for water, but I can't ask him, Usman bhai, please increase my sustenance. Because who can increase sustenance? Who can increase my risk? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, first is he should be living, he should be present, and he should be capable. And if a person is living and present and capable, then it's proven from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he has asked. And no one can say this is wrong. But for a person who's not living, who's not present, and who's not capable to do it, it's not allowed to ask. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not allowed us to do it. So now let us know, dear brothers and sisters, that وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ, only we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's aid. So all acts of ibadah, all acts of worship are for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah has given a very good definition of ibadah. Because many people make a mistake in this. He writes in his book, Al-Ubudiyah, he says, Al-Ibadah, Ismul Jami. Ibadah is a very concentrated word. لِكُلِّ مَا يُحِبُّهُ اللَّهُ وَيَرْضَاهُ. It contains everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves and which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with. Everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves and Allah is pleased with is ibadah. Min al-aqwal, whether it is those things which a person says, or amal, or a person does, az-zahira wal-batina, whether it's open or whether it's hidden. See, there are some ibadah which is hidden. Like for example, taqwa. Taqwa is ibadah. For example, hope from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, iman on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is hidden ibadah. There's some ibadah which is open, like fasting, or like salah, or a person is going for hajj. And there's some ibadah which is on the tongue, like zikr, like dua. This is all ibadah. Now, dear brothers and sisters, please notice that ibadah is everything done to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, we find some people dancing in front of the idol. What is this dancing? Why are you dancing over here? See, there may be a person who's dancing in a disco. That's haram. It's sin. But a person who's dancing in front of an idol, now this is shirk. Because that dance is ibadah for him. As Allah says in the Quran, that clapping in the house is ibadah of the mushriks. So now their ibadah is just clapping, and that's what we find now, their bells. So this is their ibadah. So now are you allowed to play, have with bells? It may be a different matter, because playing with bells is also haram. The Prophet ﷺ prohibited it. But for example, if a person is Doing it in front of the idol, this is shirk. So now we need to know all of this is ibadah, and it had the, who has the right of all of this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a slave. Where people go wrong. See, when it's so obvious, when this is so clear, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator, when He's the owner, when He's the sustainer, when He's the one who controls good, bad, life, death, why should we worship someone else? It's so obvious. Where people go wrong? Why do people go wrong? Do you know where people go wrong? Let us look at the example of the mushriks of Makkah. And dear brothers and sisters, I'm going to tell you two things about them, which if we were to share this with all the Muslims and with so many other people of the world, then possibly, you know, so many people would be saved from shirk. The mushriks of Makkah, they used to worship idols. And where were the idols? Kaaba. Where? In and around the Kaaba. How many were there? 360. And we find that they used to worship these idols. Now the first thing about them is, as given in the Quran in Surah Zukhruf, Surah number 43, verse number 87. Allah says, وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَهُمْ. If you were to ask them, them who? Mushriks of Makkah. If you were to ask them, who created you? Who created you? لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ. They will tell, surely it is Allah who created us. They will say, it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who created us. Now, dear brothers and sisters, the mushriks of Makkah, they used to worship idols, but they used to say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. And Allah says in the Quran in Surah Yunus, Surah number 10, verse number 31, if you ask them, who, قُلْ, tell them, who gives you sustenance from the heavens and from the earth? Who's the one who brings out the living from the dead and the dead from the living? Who's the one who controls all hearing and sight? Who's the one who controls everything? So they will tell you, Allah. It's given in no less than 12 places in the Quran that they used to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator, sustainer, owner, cherisher. They used to believe in all of rububiyah. They used to say Allah alone is the Rabb. We find if you read Surah Muminun, Surah number 23, verse number 84 to 90. Or if you read Surah Zukhruf, Surah number 43, ayat number 9. Or Surah Luqman, Surah number 31, verse number 25. Of Surah Ankabut, Surah number 29, verse number 65. They should believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone is the Lord, Allah is the creator, Allah is the owner. A question may come to mind that when they used to believe in all of this, then how come they used to worship these idols? Why worship these idols? When you believe Allah is the controller, giver, why are you worshipping these idols? So they had a logic. They used to say, as given and recorded in the Quran, in Surah Zumar, Surah number 39, verse number 3. You can easily memorize this. Surah number 39 and verse number 3. If you multiply 3 into 3, you get 9. 39, 3. So now we find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us what the mushriks of Makkah used to say. And do you know, dear brothers and sisters, the words of the mushriks of Makkah are there in the Quran till today, and they will always be till the day of judgment. Just as the words of Fir'aun are there in the Quran. How he used to say, Ana Rabbukum al-A'la, it's given in the Quran. Now the words of the mushriks of Makkah are also there in the Quran, and they used to say, Ma na'buduhum, we don't worship them, who? Idols. Illa, except we worship, liyuqarribuna ilallahi zulfa, so that they may take us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that they may take us, liyuqarribuna ilallahi zulfa, so that they may take us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they used to believe these are our means of coming closer to Allah. They take us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah says in the Quran in Surah Yunus, Surah number 10, verse number 18, that the mushriks of Makkah used to say, هَوْلَاي شُفَعَوْنَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. They intercede for us before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They intercede for us before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They get our things done. They're close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They bring us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They solve our problem. They get our things done. So now, dear brothers and sisters, we find that these two dedicate all acts of worship for these 360 idols. And do you know, as given in the hadith of Sahih Bukhari, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that these idols were idols of righteous people of the time of Nuh alayhi salam. From the people of Nuh alayhi salam, when righteous people, they died, Shaitan told people, said, see, what are you doing to remember their righteousness? Why not make their statues and install them in places where they used to sit? So what the people of Nuh alayhi salam, what they did is that they made statues to remember the righteousness of righteous people. Oh, so and so is such a righteous person. We make a statue over here, like we see today. We find that some great freedom fighter, some politician. So people make their statue and put it somewhere. And we've already started seeing that people start worshipping these statues also. So that's what happened with Nuh al-Islam's people. When time went by, Shaitan said that, see, these are the statues of these are the idols of the gods of your forefathers. So that's when they started worshipping these idols. So now the statues, the idols which the mushriks of Makkah used to worship, these were idols of righteous people. And they used to say, we worship them only so that they may bring us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's think now. Brothers and sisters, let's think. Instead of the idols, we find so many of our own brothers and sisters, we have graves of righteous people. Allah knows best about the people, even if the person is righteous. So now people go there, some people put a chadar. Huh? Some people put some offering. Some people kiss it with great devotion. Some people do tawaf. Some people do ruku. Some people do sajda. Some people sit there for 40 days. Some people journey from far, far distances. We ask, why are you doing all this? Why are you doing all this? So people say, لِيُقَرِبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى, so that they may bring us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. هَاُولَٰئِ شُفَاؤُنَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ, they intercede for us before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you know, these are the very same words which the mushriks of Makkah had said in the past. A question arises that why is it that the mushriks of Makkah are wrong? And if we say those same words, then we are right. Then we are good, we are correct people. How is it? How is it that the mushriks of Makkah are wrong when they said that? And if we say those same words, then it's okay, we are Muslims. Why is it so? Brothers and sisters, this is shirk. People say that, see, don't you need stairs to go up? Yes, we need stairs to go up. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot be compared to that floor which is up. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is closer to us than a jugular vein. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Qaf, Surah 50, verse number 16, I'm closer to you than your jugular vein. Tell me, if a person is calling out some righteous person, oh so and so, help me. Tell me, who is more closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Who is more closer to us? Is that person more closer to us? Or Allah is more closer to us? Who is more closer? Allah is more closer. As Allah says in the Quran, I'm closer to you than your jugular vein. Can anyone be more closer? Who is more merciful? Can that great person be more merciful than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or is Allah is the most merciful? Then will we leave the most merciful and call out someone who is not the most merciful? This is a mistake. This is where the people have gone wrong. So dear brothers and sisters, all of these examples which people give, people say that, see, to go to the judge, you need a lawyer, don't you? Yes, we need a lawyer to go to the judge. We need a lawyer to go to the judge. Because the judge doesn't understand my problem. So I need a lawyer who can explain to him in his own legal language. The judge cannot even listen to two lawyers at one time. Can you compare the judge to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah listens to crores and crores of human beings. He can understand our problem better than what we understand ourselves. A person, when he's troubled, he says, I can't even talk about my problem. Allah knows what's his problem. How can we compare him to the judge? The judge, you need a lawyer, because he's a human being. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's none like him. So Allah said, don't give examples for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These examples are all wrong. All of them, if someone tells you these examples, please remember something. They said, to go to a principal, you need a pune. Allah is not like the principal. To go to the first floor, you need stairs. Allah is not like that first floor. To go to the judge, you need a lawyer. Allah is not like the judge. To reach out water which is in a well, you need a rope. Allah is not like that water which is far. Allah is closer to us than a jugular vein. These examples are wrong for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why people do shirk. So many human beings, they say, you ask so many other brothers who belong to other faiths. You ask them that, Parmeshwar kitna, Parmatma kitne hai? They say, ek, sab ka malik ek. They say that. But why? Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Yusuf, Surah number 12, verse number 106, وَمَا يُؤْمِنُوا أَكْثَرُهُمْ بِاللَّهِ إِلَّا بَهُمْ مُشْرِكُونَ. Most of them, they believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they also do shirk. Most of them, they believe in Allah, but they do shirk. And this is what's happening. So now, dear brothers and sisters, this is Tawheed. And this is what the Prophet ﷺ preached. This was the first message which he passed on. This is the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on his creation. If a person understands Tawheed, he's come on Tawheed, there's hope that one day he will finally go to Jannah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. He may forgive a sin other than that to whoever he wills. So there's hope. But if a person has done shirk, even if he has done many, many great things, there's no hope for him. So now, dear brothers and sisters, this is all tawheed. Three aspects. And we need to pass in all three. And Allah says in the Quran, in Surah An'am, Surah 6, verse number 81, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. They do not value Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as they should have valued. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his struggle was to pass on the message of La ilaha illallah. The mushriks of Makkah, they used to believe Allah is the Rabb. If our kalima was La Rabba illallah, there was no problem for our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They used to believe, Rabb is only Allah. The problem was, they used to say, we worship these 360 idols. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, you know, you need to worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only Allah needs to be worshipped. It's Allah's right on the creation that Allah alone should be worshipped. And dear brothers and sisters, this is tawheed. All of this has to be maintained. Little bit shirk is also not allowed. A person misses out on tawheed, he's gone. There's no hope for him. This is the biggest of despair in the akhirah, that a person comes with shirk in a scale of deeds. So now, dear brothers and sisters, all of this said. Finally, we see a verse of the Quran and we end our talk. The verse we see is from Suratul Luqman, Surah number 31, verse number 13. Luqman, he said to his child, he said, Ya Bunayya, O my son, La tushrik billah, do not associate partners with Allah. Do not associate partners with Allah. Inna shirka la zulmun azim. Because shirk is the biggest zulm. The biggest zulm which is happening on planet Earth is shirk. The biggest injustice, the biggest wrongdoing. The worst sin that's happening on the face of this earth is shirk. Zulmun azim. You know what zulm? You take someone's right and you give it to someone else. It's Allah's right that He alone should be worshipped. And people worship Allah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is zulmun azim. Now Luqman alayhi salam, Luqman the wise man, he's an example for every Muslim father. All fathers over here. All mothers sitting in the sister section. Dear brothers and sisters, he's an example. Make your children strong in tawheed. Tawheed, they should understand strongly, perfectly. Allah is right on man, they should understand perfectly. And other things also, inshallah, they should be good. Make them strong in tawheed. Teach them tawheed. And first, we should learn tawheed. We should study tawheed. We need to know and memorize ayat of the Quran, which are there with us all the time. And do you know, dear brothers and sisters, there's an example of a father talking to a son over here. But there's another example of a son talking to a father somewhere else in the Quran. Who can tell where? Son talking to a father. Ibrahim al-Islam. That's right. Ibrahim al-Islam, if we read Surah Maryam, he's talking to his father. Ya Abati, oh my father. He's explaining to his father. And we find Ibrahim al-Islam is the example for every child. That if your parents don't know Tawheed, pass on Tawheed to them. He's an example for us. So now what do we learn? We learn that if the father knows Tawheed, he needs to teach. If the parents know Tawheed, they need to teach the child. And if the child knows Tawheed, he needs to teach his parents. Whoever knows has to pass it on. Has to pass it on. I'll end with the verse of the Quran in Surah Al-Isra, Surah 17, verse number 111. فَكَبِّرْهُ تَكْبِيرًا. Then glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as He should be. Praise Him. Mention His greatness as He should be. Don't just believe in the greatness. Mention His greatness. We need to go on and pass on the message of Tawheed, dear brothers and sisters. We need to pass on this beautiful message to whoever we can in our lifetime. And this is what I want to invite all of you to join us in this purpose. Don't just take this as a dars which you just sat and went back. I suggest that you take this as a training session. As a training session. And we have notes on the subject. Notes in English and Urdu. Take the notes. Start memorizing. Save someone from shirk. If you can save someone from shirk, possibly it will be like how the Prophet ﷺ said to Ali radhiyallahu anhu, "Khayrul laka min humurin nam." It's better for you than the red camels. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept us for the services of His way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who maintain the tawheed and save ourselves from shirk. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Wa ma khalaqtul jinna wal insa illa liya'budun. Ma uridu minhum min rizqin wa ma uridu an yut'imun.